भारत के रत्न परम आदरणीय श्री प्रणब मुखर्जी, पद्मश्री परम आदरणीय श्री राम बहादुर जी, डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, इट इज अ मैटर ऑफ प्रिविलेज एंड प्राइड फॉर मी टू बी प्रेजेंट हियर टुडे and to be able to express some of my own learnings and experiences related to the realm of education in the august presence of Sri Pranab Mukherjee. I, as Vice Chancellor, had the privilege of having him as the visitor of the University of Delhi, and I witnessed firsthand not just his love and affection for me personally, but his guiding hand, not just for the University of Delhi, but for all central universities, of which, as president, he was the ex officio visitor. As Ram Bahadur ji just mentioned, he would regularly meet with all vice chancellors, he would inspire us, he would guide us, he would make us talk, he would make us converse, and the air at Rashtrapati Bhavan was vibrant with innovation and ingenuity. We looked forward to such engagements. I'm deeply grateful to you, sir, for all the guidance that you gave me. And what I express here is largely derived during my time as the Vice Chancellor, and I had the advantage of his guiding hand. I'm also deeply grateful to Ram Bahadur ji, who has also been a mentor for me. In my hours of crisis, he has always helped me understand what is the right path of action. And that is what education is all about. Why are we gathered here? We are gathered here because all of us realize that education is central to the well-being of a nation, to the well-being of society. And we are gathered here because we also have some concerns related to the state of education, not just in India, but the world at large too. However, my comments are largely confined to my country because that's where my experiences lie. I hark back, sir, to the time when Srinivas Ramanujan was attempting to clear the first year BA examination at Madras University. It was known at that time by all those who knew him personally that he is extraordinarily gifted at mathematics, but he kept failing regularly in the English language. And Madras University failed to award him a degree, let alone a degree, they could not even promote him to the next year. At this point in time, the distinguished British mathematician G.H. Hardy realized that Ramanujan was a genius extraordinary, and he sent for Ramanujan to come to Cambridge. And he proclaimed to all Indians that this man is a genius, and yet Madras University failed to promote him. The point I'm trying to make is, sir, that 120 years later, when I was Vice Chancellor of the University of Delhi, had Ramanujan come to me again, I would not have been able to do anything for him. I'm bound by rules and regulations that are not of my choosing or making. They come to me from higher institutions like the UGC and the HRD Ministry. Had I admitted Ramanujan under some strange powers that I would have imagined I have, I can assure you of following. One, I would have been stopped by the UGC that would have told me, has he cleared his net? Does he have a JRF? So on and so forth. And an inquiry would have been set upon me. Nothing seems to have changed in India. This Ramanujan, when he traveled to Cambridge, they gave him a PhD degree, never asked, does he have a bachelor's degree or anything like that. But it isn't just about that. There are other issues at stake. Things are not the way we wanted them to be, and they haven't been so for a long time. Lest you get the impression that I'm pessimistic, no, I don't want you to think like that. India is doing its bit for education, and we make progress constantly. Alas, the progress is not good enough. We made good progress when Sri Pranab Mukherjee was the president of India. I wish the momentum is sustained, and I'm out of touch with things, so I cannot vouch for what is happening at this point in time. However, let me just get back to how things exist at this point in my own university. When I was vice chancellor, I happened to be in Sydney and engaged the services of a taxi which was being driven by a young Indian. I got talking to him. It turned out he had a first-class degree in BCom honors from one of our most distinguished colleges known for its high cutoffs. I asked him why was he driving a cab, and this young boy told me that he came to Australia having migrated with great hopes after taking a first-class degree in BCom honors, thinking that he will conquer the world. And he was disappointed, he said, to learn when he landed there that they told him he knew nothing worthwhile. And this boy began to weep. Ye rone laga. Kaha ki hamare saath dhoka hota hai. When he found out I'm the vice chancellor, he said, kuch kijiye. Sare bachchon ko barbaad kiya jata hai. When I came back, I checked. In this very college, more than half the people who graduate in the BA BCom honors program remain unemployed during campus employment. Think about this. There is something not right here. I also had another experiment. I persuaded a well-known, very established international corporation in finance to come to the University of Delhi and employ first degree holders at suitable jobs, which would pay, this was 8 years ago, pay something like 30,000 rupees a month. They did not ask for anything special. All they wanted was that you have basic communication skills and basic data skills, simple data. We chose 1,200 of the best resumes that we received amongst the thousands. And they flew a whole team from Bombay and they came down here. They interviewed blind all these students, all 1,200, one by one. Guess how many they hired? So they hired only 3 students. It was a telling comment on the state of things that the University of Delhi was providing. And let me assure you, the university was consistently perceived as being better than most universities in India. So I leave it to your imaginations to think what the other universities were doing. And the story goes on and on. It doesn't stop. So let us be agreed that things were not right and have not been right for some time. They can be much better. And that is what brings me to this other state. How do we decide what is the right course of action? Without trying to seem chauvinistic, I want to hark back a little to the past in India when we had great knowledge systems. What did they do? What was the secret? Was there some magic formula that they employed? And I speak of Nalanda, Takshashila, Vallabhi, Vikramshila, so on and so forth. They had great ideas. And they were connected to the needs, wants, and challenges of the nation and of society. And they helped build India into a knowledge economy. And let me quickly illustrate at the little time at my disposal what I mean by that. There is a tiny island off Madagascar called Socotra. Yeah, on this island, it is so tiny, it's hard to detect on the map. On this island, almost since the time of the Christ, Indian merchant ships used to sail from India across the entire Indian Ocean and land at that island. How do we know this? We have the inscriptions on the walls of the caves of this island written by sailors who traveled on these ships. And all of them are in the Brahmi script. So you can imagine how old it is. They have been dated. Why could they do this? Because India had mastered sea routes. We knew how to determine position at sea. At that point in time, when Newton tells the British Parliament that science knows no means of determining position at sea, Indian ships used to routinely cross the Indian Ocean and on the other side using an instrument called the rubber guy based on a mathematical idea coming out of knowledge systems in India. And how did it help the economy? That's what I mean by a knowledge economy. Our ships were better built because they came out of knowledge systems in India. They traveled faster, more accurately, and could trade at will and return, unlike European ships, which would needlessly get lost most of the time. This isn't just about our ships. This isn't just about traveling by sea. Indian knowledge systems were so advanced from since before the time of the Christ. India was the first country in the world to invent not just plastic surgery, but also cataract surgery. And where did I learn this, sir? Not in any institution in India. I learned this at Columbia University and at Johns Hopkins University, where they acknowledge with conviction that India was a world leader from since before the time of the Christ. And when you have to do such fine surgery, You need implements of an extraordinarily fine nature. And how did India manage to forge such instruments? Not only did they forge, they exported them. Not only did they export the knowledge, they exported implements. That came out of the famous Wood's steel that India had mastered. We were the best in the world for centuries in the art of making Wood's steel. The famous Damascus sword was nothing but Wood's steel from India being forged in Damascus. What was so special about the Wood's steel that even Michael Faraday in the 18th century would also use the Wood's steel from India? And India has lost the art of making Wood's steel now. I've checked with many people. No one seems to know how they made Wood's steel all the way up to the 18th century. In the 19th century, under British influence, we lost faith in ourselves. I'm trying to advise you to realize this fact. And if you don't believe me, read the monumental work by Angus Maddison, where he says that from the first century AD till the beginnings of the 18th century, India dominated the world's economy. China was second. Why was that? Because India was a knowledge economy. So what was special? There was something special happening there. And let me very quickly enunciate what it was. There's nothing secret about this. There were four or five principles embedded in our knowledge systems and in society. One, all our learning happened in a transdisciplinary fashion. All of it happened with connections to the real world. All of it happened in practical ways. The Mimamsa School of Philosophy says that knowledge without action is meaningless. That was the tradition in India. That is why you had wood, steel, rappel guys, so on and so forth. The calculus was invented in India 500 years before Newton by Bhaskaracharya II. And India has a glorious tradition of continuous inventions in calculus up to the time of Newton and even beyond. And so let us look back. Transdisciplinarity, hands-on project work. This is best exemplified by the story, the true story of the Chandogya Upanishad, where Satyakam Jabala, once he is admitted to the Gurukul of Gautam Haridrumath, is not asked to go recite the Vedas. Haridrumath tells him to take this 100 head of cattle, go to the forest and not return until they have multiplied threefold. This is a project in action where knowledge is gained from real world experiences and challenges. When Satyakam returns, Haridrumath says that you have acquired enlightenment. So I am trying to tell you that has always been India's tradition. What is India like now? All our learning in the University of Delhi is largely blackboard driven. I can tell you with certainty what we do in schools when we are asked to analyze those 12 standard salts from since before my time till today in chemistry. They are known in advance. The same standard salts exist. Not one school, not one curriculum prescribes. Let the child pick up some soil from the school and analyze the salts in that soil. Let him understand what his own soil around him is like. No one does that. That is what is happening in our university system. It is largely blackboard driven. We are all aware that India is deficient in importing. It has to consistently import aeroplanes for defense and for passenger work. No such planes are manufactured in India. What we don't know, what most of us here may not know, is that we have been teaching a subject called fluid dynamics to all math and physics students for decade after decade in almost every university of India, only on the blackboard. This subject is critical to the manufacture of aeroplanes. No one connects, not one student have I come across in my university who has studied fluid dynamics and knows that you can do this, use this to make planes. That is the tragedy of India. That is the tragedy that we have incurred consistently in education. So how do I embody these principles that were there in the past and also something in the future, something in the present here that will take us into the future? Again, I hark back to some great names from the past, and those principles are embedded even in their lives. And I speak of Mahatma Gandhi, Rabindranath Tagore, Michael Faraday, Albert Einstein, Newton, Kabir, Guru Nanak, Paigambar Sahab, all of them. Let us not forget that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, worked as an apprentice to his father for carpentry. This use of the hands is critical for knowledge. Knowledge and skills are two sides of the same coin. Very few people know that Albert Einstein was extraordinarily gifted as a craftsman. He had more than 50 patents and inventions to his credit, including the first safe modern refrigerator, the first automatic camera, so on and so forth. This is all in addition to relativity. So he was a gifted craftsman. That is true of Faraday. That is true of Kabir, who was such a great weaver. Mahatma Gandhi churned the charkha, all of them. Paigambar Sahab was a shepherd. Guru Nanak used to work in agricultural fields, and he made all his followers also work there. That is something that has been taken away from the education tradition in India. And we are losing out. Knowledge is ceased to be generated in a way that will benefit India and put us on the top and make us a knowledge economy. I see all the dangers ahead. I can see that India is under threat in this realm. Why do I say that? I say that because it is evident. Let me illustrate quickly. You know that one of our biggest export items is ready-made garments. India exports in billions of dollars each year. And the Honorable President has in his role, and he has served India in almost every capacity. I do not know in which capacity, sir, you have not touched the well-being of the nation. And he knows very well that commerce, our practices, our regulations have helped build up this trade. Why is it that India excels in this in addition to good regulations which sir had put in place? There are some other reasons. Labor is cheap in India. It isn't that people in the West do not have nimble fingers. It's just that it is cheap in India. What we haven't realized and are not taking cognizance of is that the West has already invented extraordinarily adept and expert robotic tailors that can stitch anything. I have seen demonstrations of these tailors. Our entire export business in garments is under threat. And if you think it is just about garments and just a few billion dollars over there, think again. Nike and other companies are using 3D printers now to make shoes. Once again, we will lose out. We only have cheap labor here. That is why we make shoes. The story goes on and on. How does India then move ahead? So let me quickly relate. Under the guidance of Pranab Mukherjee Sahab, when he was visitor, we initiated some reforms at the University of Delhi. What were these reforms all about? We embedded in them the principles that I talk about, which we learned from the lives of the great names I initiated and from India's past. We introduced into this system many things. So first and foremost, we redefined education. What do we mean by education? Well, I have just one simple definition. I'm a mathematician. Education has just one definition. It is the search of the self. You delve within. Antaratma ki khoj hai. Is antaratma ko kaise samjha jaye? I liken it to a drum beat within. And how do you discover your drum beat? That is what education is all about. You discover your drum beat and you discover this drum beat and march in the real world in harmony with this drum beat and you begin to get educated. This process is a lifelong process. Very few of us will be able to say we have been educated. It continues for our entire lives. But how do we discover that drumbeat? Well, here's a simple analogy. When you are in school, I'm sure you've come across tuning forks. And you have two tuning forks which you strike against some wooden piece and then they hum. If they are in harmony, there's a certain kind of harmonious sound generated. Otherwise, there is discord. The idea is to allow each individual young mind that enters a system of education to be exposed to various drum beats. And then from that exposure, he will find that drum beat which has harmony with something inside him. And this has very little to do with formal degrees. That is why I consider Sachin Tendulkar as highly educated, even though he does not have a single university degree. Because he discovered his drum beat in school, which was cricket. Similarly, Mahatma Gandhi, who had no university degree, don't think that as a lawyer he had a degree, he just qualified to practice law. Mahatma Gandhi discovered his drumbeat at a very young age, this adherence to the truth, no matter what the cost. And then he became educated, he became father of the nation. That's the name of the game. You define education as this process by which you allow young minds to discover their drumbeats. And that is what we did under your guidance, sir. We introduced innovation projects, we redefined the curriculum, we allowed hands-on practice, group work, project work, and in just 1 year, we had astonishing results. Undergraduates began to produce knowledge, they set up startups, they created research papers and patents. University of Delhi in its rankings shot up to almost 200 above all the IITs except Kanpur and Bombay. And remember, each IIT is just like one of our colleges. We were really getting there. Alas, things have begun to slide, not just in my university, but in this country, because over implementation of regulations. We have such a strong regulatory framework for everything. That is what needs to be removed. We do not need a huge overarching policy. We need to allow good minds to be put in place and give them freedom to create within their systems something new. And that is the second point I wish to enunciate here, sir. Getting good leaders in academic institutions is of paramount importance. I will give very quickly three illustrations, and I beg your indulgence for a little time, sir. In India, in the late 40s, around the time that Sardar Patel was about to pass away, but because of him, the first woman vice chancellor of the world was appointed at Baroda University. Her name was Hansa Mehta. She did not even have a master's degree. And she was vice chancellor for 9 years. And she built such strong foundations. She laid such a lovely foundation for Baroda University that till today it remains a really good university because of the momentum, practices, and traditions she put in place. She didn't even have a master's. The UGC prescribes, sir, you have to have a PhD, you have to have 10 years of experience, you have to have done this and that and so on. We will never get good people this way. But that is not the only example. In my own university, this university really became the University of Delhi when Maurice Guire became the vice chancellor, who was no academic, who had no PhD, who had no publications. And he was vice chancellor, sir, for 12 years. And he made Delhi University what it is. And this is during the time before and after independence. And the same story is repeated at Princeton University in the 60s. And we must learn from these practices. At Princeton, in the 60s, there was a young man, 30 years of age, not even a permanent assistant professor. He was on contract as an assistant professor. His name was Robert Goheen. The board of trustees saw something special in him. And overnight, they made him president of Princeton University. He was president for more than 20 years, and he made Princeton what it is today. The UGC would never have allowed this. India needs to think about this. India needs to work towards a framework that allows us to rediscover our past. And why am I so worried? We are in grave danger. Artificial intelligence, the internet, quantum computing, so many of these new realms of human endeavor are coming into place, and India will be overtaken unless India does something in this regard. And that is why India should learn somehow a little from the past, somehow from the modern practices, and some of the experiences that we had at the University of Delhi under the benevolent guidance and wisdom of Sri Pranab Mukherjee, so that we could chart through redefining education a productive and constructive path for India. That is all I have to say today. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.